At the conclusion of our last lecture, we were noting that if one does not go through steps 1 and 2 in order to get to step 3, there are one of two things that will happen. On the one hand, there are those texts that will stay in the first century and simply never become a word from God to us. For example, in 1 Corinthians, if we have no one in our context who is struggling with the problem of whether or not to join his pagan neighbors at the feasts in the idol temple, then the text there will have nothing to say to us. Or if we have no one who is denying the bodily resurrection, or if our culture does not insist on head coverings, or if we have no one drunk at the Lord's table, or if we have no one in our churches shouting, "Jesus anathema, Jesus be cursed," then the epistles merely become historical interests to us at this point, or at these points, but they scarcely address us. Now, if those words are going to somehow move into our situation, the only way they can do that is for us to listen to what was being said back there and then move. As I said, the other possibility, of course, is that the word never belongs to the first century, is immediately transferred into the 20th century through our grid. Words mean certain things to us already when we come to it, and especially this is true in English, be true in those who are French-speaking. Is simply, you already have, the meaning of words is already fixed by your culture and context. Then you bring that meaning back to the word when you read it and immediately make a transfer that sometimes leads us to make texts mean what they don't mean. There is, for example, in 1 Corinthians 11, 26, 27, the word that says, if anyone eats or drinks of the cup of the Lord unworthily, he eats or drinks damnation to himself. I spent a great deal of anxiety in my childhood at every communion as to whether or not I should partake. I had, in fact, accepted Christ, but I wasn't always living that. And it says, whoever eats or drinks unworthily, which means you can't do it with sin in your life, lest I come under damnation and be doomed to hell, I passed up the communion many times. That was really rather unfortunate because that was precisely what I needed, was the communion. I was out of touch, and I needed God's grace graciously extended to me precisely where it is tangibly so done in our communal experience of the reception of the Lord's Supper, where by faith, once again, I experience His forgiveness and receive the ministry of His grace. Well, the text does not mean unworthily equals sin in one's life. What the text means is that if anyone eats or drinks in an unworthy manner, it is in a context of people who are being gluttons in a meal that precedes the Lord's table, and who are actually being drunken so that when they come to the Lord's table, they are not in any way able to appreciate what is going on at the table of the Lord. It has to do with the manner in which they're eating and drinking. It doesn't have to do with, quote, whether you've got sin in your life. Now let a man examine himself. That means let a person sit under the judgment of God as to what these items, these elements in the communion are all about. And in that manner, let him come and eat and drink. But those who are his are precisely the ones who are invited to that table. And in fact, if it took worthiness, none of us is there anyway, are we? That is, that's precisely where we're all left out, is whether or not we're worthy. So the point is that that text is very often transferred into our context without listening to what the Word of God is, you see. And that's the thing that we need to wrestle with and keep from doing. Now, what I ordinarily do at this point is to illustrate all of this by taking a piece of text and working through it. But we're going to do that in a kind of negative way at this point, because I'm going to save that material until we come to it in the course of the lectures, and that will be tomorrow morning. But the text that I have in mind is chapter 3, verses 10 to 17. It is an absolutely perfect place to illustrate this. At the present moment, in fact, I am grading a group of 135 papers from a class at the seminary in which their assignment was to deal with the structures of the Greek in this paragraph and sort of put the Greek out in a way that you can see the flow of the argument, and then out beside the Greek text that they are now rewriting to write in English the argument, trace the argument in terms of what you see going on over here in the Greek text. I felt that it would be a perfectly good kind of exercise that would cause them to be able to see what the text means without having my tell them. But I've already read some of those papers, and I am amazed, absolutely amazed, at one paper in particular out of 14 that I've read so far. And he starts the argument in verse 10, "According to the commission of God given to me like a skilled master builder, I laid a foundation, and another man is building upon it. Let each one take care how he builds upon it." And he starts the argument by saying what Paul is talking about here is the fact that he has laid the foundation for the Christian life. And now he says, this student is arguing, let each one take care how he builds his life upon the foundation that has been laid, namely Jesus Christ. And then he spends the rest of the text arguing that even though he builds his life badly, he's going to be saved, though as by fire. Now my suggestion to you is that the text never meant that. It never will mean that. If it ever has meant that, it has only meant that because you have totally blown the text. It simply doesn't mean that. Now, when one comes to verses 16 and 17, "Do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in you?" That surely seems to justify that former interpretation. But in fact, that is precisely the text that causes us to be sure that that was the wrong interpretation of verses 10 to 15. Now, I'm not going to give the answer to that. That's my way of making sure that you come to class tomorrow. No, not really. But we will we will take that up. Now, the reason for using this particular piece of text as an illustration is that what we would do, what I ordinarily do then, and we're going to do it tomorrow, we're just going to go through these steps and show you what one has to do in coming to grips with a piece of text. And that it doesn't take expertise in Greek ordinarily. Now, in this instance, it does help to know a little bit about the Greek language because of the plural singular you that comes out in English. That's not true in French. I suppose that in French they wouldn't have made that mistake. But in English it's a very easy mistake because of the singular and the plural. You is identical in English and not so in Greek, and that would have come out clearly. Although not necessarily. I know people who run right past those singulars and plurals in the languages that do have them and still make the same mistake. But at least that's a place where a little Greek, you know, never hurt anybody, as it were. But we'll have to take note of those kinds of things as we come to them. But the point is, we want to find out what is God saying. And the problem in this text is that the very thing that God is saying to us in that text, it isn't the only place in the New Testament where he says that, but it is the only place where it is said so beautifully and so well and so powerfully. And when we miss what God is saying, we have taken a piece of the Bible and simply laid it aside and never hear what God is saying to us. Now, I'm concerned about that. We're going to listen to what the text says. And so one has to start at step one. Now, as I said, we're not going to do that right now, but we must say some things as to what is involved in step one. And that's what we're going to lay out now before us for a few moments in this lecture. That is, what do we do at step one, at exegesis? And then secondly, we'll say some things about step three, which is the area that concerns me greatly. Now, about step one, about exegesis. Good exegetical questions are of two kinds. They are questions of context and questions of content. Context and content. And all the exegetical questions can somehow be brought under these two large questions. First, and always first, are the questions of context. We want to know two kinds of things about context. One is the historical context. The historical context tells us about things that aren't immediately in the text. That is, we want to know all about Corinth. We want to know about the ancient world into which Paul is speaking in the church in Corinth. We want to know the geography, the topography, the economics, the sociology, all of those things that make up first century Corinth and what kind of people they were, the historical context. And we're going to come back and say a few things about that right here in a few moments. The second contextual question has to do with the literary context. That is, the context in which any passage is found in the document itself. That's what you ordinarily think of when you say context. You mean, what is it saying in its immediate literary context? But there are two levels of literary context. There is, first of all, the context of the whole letter. And that's the other thing we're going to do this hour, is to spend some time talking about the whole letter, what's going on in the entire letter. Because it's important for us to have that before us. And that's why the assignment was given, read the whole letter through at one sitting. You start by reading the whole thing through before you go back and start reading carefully 1-1. That is, you don't study a document by starting with verse 1-1 and then spending a lot of time doing careful exegesis of 1-1, 2, 3, you know. You start by reading the whole document, getting it in front of you, having a feeling for some things about that document, and then in that context, go back, and you make some provisional judgments. You make some provisional judgments about what's going on in the letter. And you're not suggesting you know all the answers, but you have some feelings about where it's going, you know, what's happening. You want to have a sense of the tone of the, what kind of letter it is, all of those kinds of questions, and we'll come back to those. But that's the whole letter. And then in that whole letter, there is the second context, which is the immediate context. The immediate context. And the basic question in the immediate context is, what's the point? What's the point? But what's the point, I keep asking you over and over and over again. What's the point? It isn't enough to hear, oh, he said this, and it means this. Yes, I understand, that's what it means. Now, what's the point of this? Given that he's already said this and he was making this point, now what's the point of this paragraph? Now, this is one of the reasons, you understand, why any Bible, be careful here, but it's true, any Bible that gives you Scripture, every verse a paragraph, is an anathema. It is a curse. And the reason it is a curse is because it destroys the contexts in which those passages are written. And the moment you destroy the context in which those passages are written, you're no longer listening to the Word of God. Paul didn't write it that way. In fact, he would look at your versification where every verse is a paragraph and he'd say, I wrote that? You know, he'd come unglued. It is simply not the way it was written. Now, it might be convenient for you for having a quick eye to run through and find 1 Corinthians 7:26 in a hurry, but so what? I mean, I would rather take you 5 more seconds to find 7:26 and find out that 7:26 is in the midst of a paragraph in which Paul wrote rather than being able to quickly find a verse that isn't even a sentence necessarily in Paul. Now, that is a destruction of the text. Paul wrote in paragraphs. He wrote in large blocks of ideas. What's the point in this? Having said this, now what's he trying to say to us? And you've got to start thinking that way. If you don't start thinking that way, you're really going to do it in. And you can do that. That doesn't take any expertise. Just start to think paragraphs. And listen, every time you come across a verse. Now, one of the reasons we've done that is that we have allowed ourselves in our devotional reading of Scripture to to read Scripture with a kind of, where's a word from God for me today, you know, approach. Now, that's okay. But what happens is we read, and we're not after what's being said. We're after some catchy sentence or catchy phrase. And once we find the catchy phrase, God has spoken to us today. Quite apart from what God means or what the context is, some catchy phrase really turns us on. Now, that's okay. That's permissible. But don't let that become the meaning of the text. And don't let that be some kind of substitute for Bible study. I mean, you know, I'm not convinced that it's any more the Word of God to us and any more sacred if one puts his finger down on a text and you have a certain combination of words, and because it's in Scripture, those combination of words are some kind of a magical word from God for you today. I mean, one might as well put his finger down in Milton. Milton says some good things too, and God can just as easily address you from Milton out of context, putting that words can get into a certain collocation and, you know, a certain syntax and arrangement and can really speak to my situation. But that's not a word. That's not the Word of God. You know, the obverse of that, of course, is that is to use that as a way of really finding out the will of God. Judas went out and hanged himself. Go thou and do likewise. You know, it's really not the nature of hearing what God is saying, or like the fellow that went to Morocco because he opened it too soon, and it said Morocco leather. And that's how he... I mean, just because it happens to be between the pages doesn't mean that that kind of nonsense somehow makes it God's Word. God's Word is what God is intending to say to us. That's what God's Word is. And just a happy combination of words in a phrase, completely out of context, you know, it's what I call promise boxing the Scripture. Now, it's quite true. If the promise is there, and it is a promise for all times, then take it out and put it in your box, if you will. But you probably ought to think context even then. So what's the point? Contextual questions. Now, the second set of questions are content. And here, very frankly, many times you're going to need the help of the experts. Now, that's not a bad thing to say. It's simply a recognition that God has given a variety of gifts in the church, and there are those who have taken the time to learn the original language and to wrestle with the syntactical, grammatical, philological questions, have to do with how the Greek, you know, what the Greek means, but they're the content questions. Content questions will have to do with the meaning of words. What does this word mean? It will have to do with grammar and this kind of thing. But is this going to make a difference if Paul says something in the plural or in the singular with regard to that text in chapter 3? Now let me just say a word about words. The meaning of words. It's one of the worst and easiest ways to do the Bible in. What I call the concordance study. Now that's, again, that's not a bad thing, but it can be abused. One can take the idea that a word has a meaning, and that once a word has a meaning, that it always has that meaning. Now, what you need to hear, and I don't know how to emphasize this any more strongly than I will do, words only have meaning in context. Only in context. A word by itself doesn't mean anything. Now, do you understand that? In the dictionary, a word never means anything. All a dictionary does is to give you the possibilities as to what it might mean in a given context, but a word only has meaning in context. Now, to how many of you does the word Maudine mean anything? Just a vowel, she knows. Well, what if I were to say Maudine is a sweetheart? Now that might make you begin to have some awareness of the word. That happens to be my wife. That's her name. Now, by itself, it doesn't mean anything to you. But I can start to put that in context, so it will then give that word some meaning. Now, the same thing is true with a whole host of Greek words, thousands upon thousands of Greek words. And sometimes it's not easy at all. There is a word, for example. Sometimes words don't even mean what they mean. You know what I mean? That is, words are metaphors. They obviously are intended to mean something else than what they ordinarily mean. But they mean that metaphorical thing in this context. There is a Greek word, skuos. The Greek word skuos ordinarily means vessel. It is the word that if you were to say to somebody, go out and put water in that skuos, in that earthen vessel. It's the ostrakina type thing, you know, those kinds of things that are simply made of that earthenware. It's the ordinary word for skuos. But other things can mean, you know, it means vessel, so a number of things. Even a ship can sometimes be a skuos, but not very often. That's, as in English, that becomes a transferred meaning. Okay, now, in 1 Thessalonians 4:4, Paul says, well, I don't remember the exact Greek, so I'm going to have to check for a moment. I've got the Greek right here in front of me. Good. Paul says that this is the will of God, even your sanctification, to abstain from, and here's another word that's going to be difficult to translate, but to abstain from sexual immorality. That's the broadest possibility there, and I'll keep that one for now. To know, that is, that each man is to know how to have his own skuos, or to keep, or to control, whatever it means, or to acquire. The verb is very difficult there. But each man is to know how to acquire or to keep his own skuos in holiness and in honor. Now, clearly, skuos is metaphorical here. It will have nothing to do with earthenware vessels. But what is the metaphorical intention? Is it wife or is it body? And if he means body, that's not the same thing as wife, by a long shot. And the whole text hinges on the meaning of that word. And it is the most difficult passage in 1 Thessalonians precisely because it is a very difficult thing to try to finally decide. There is good evidence on one side, and then there's some things that are against that, and then there's some good evidence on the other side. Now, I happen personally to think it means body. Let each man know how to control his own body. His meaning now body, even body meaning in a more transferred sense, his own person. Not body, just, you know, the flesh, but his person. Let each man know how to keep or control his own body in holiness and in purity. But it might mean, let each man, you know, have his own wife. That is, take a wife instead of being an adulterer or a and I couldn't be an adulterer, but a fornicator. Now, that's another possibility. Now, your translations are going to make a choice. You know, they've got to make a choice there. But you've got to come to grips with the meaning of words, and words only have meaning in context. So this is my moment to say my words against the Amplified Bible. And something needs to be said against that somewhere along the way for everybody. It is absolutely the worst imaginable thing that could have been done. It is not translation. It is a translation that tries to do lexicography at the same time, and you can't do that. Now, this is what I mean. There are places where there are as many as 10 different choices that are being suggested for the meaning of a word. Now, you know what goes on in the person's mind who reads that? He says, ha-ha, it can mean any one of these 10 things, and so you pick one. And you pick the one you like the best, quite apart from any study or any knowledge of what it could mean. You just simply, hey, I like that. And so, since it could mean any one of these 10 things, according to the Amplified Bible, you pick one, and it might mean exactly the opposite of that. It might be totally, you know, away from what is intended. The point is, the author intended something. And far better to make a mistake, but choose, than to let the lay person, as it were, simply go around making his choices all the time as to the meaning of words. Here is one of those places where the person who knows the possibilities ought to give his gifts to the church, make a choice. Far better that than to just put someone on his own and say, hey, it can mean any one of these 10 things. It can't either mean any one of those 10 things. It can only mean one thing in that text. Now, among those 10, it might, you know, one of those might be the possible one, but it can only mean one of those. And the Amplified Bible suggests it can mean any one of those 10 things. Just pick and choose as you go. Next time you read it, you might like it to mean the other thing, you know. So whenever you read it, it means something different. Well, that is not possible. It means what it means what it means. And it only means what it means in context. Therefore, a word has only, except in those rare instances where there are intentional double meanings. You know, double entente. That's a perfectly good possibility. That's a play on words. But we ordinarily don't expect authors to be playing games with us. They use words with intention. So, context, content questions. Now, those are the kinds of things, if you will, where you need to learn to use commentaries. You need to learn to ask questions of those who are working with the material. You need to do that. Because the content questions are not always the kinds of questions that everybody reading an English text can have readily available to him. But for the most part, those answers can be found by consulting the proper references. But the context questions you can learn to ask. And it seems to me that that's where my urgency for you lies, right here. We need to learn to start asking the context questions. Even if we don't always ask them correctly, and even if we don't always come to the right conclusions, we must learn to do it. Because that is what is, you know, heavy upon us. That's the urgency. What is the point? Now, I want to just go back and deal with those two content questions then in a little bit of the time that we have remaining this morning. First of all, something about the historical context. Now, I suppose that it would be to our advantage to know something about the city of Corinth. Now, this isn't going to always be true. You know, Corinth is Ephesus, is, you know, one pagan city in pagan antiquity is as pagan as another. Perhaps. But I would dare say to you that there's a difference between Lausanne, Switzerland, and Calcutta, India. They both are pagan. And if you Swiss don't like me to say that, you need to come to grips with that's a reality. Just because it's Western doesn't mean that it's not pagan. Pagan has to do whether, in fact, there is obedience to God going on. They're both pagan, but they're different. Radically so. And in fact, in the same country, there's a difference between a city like New York City and a town in upstate New York, or between Boston and some town in New Hampshire in New England. There are radical differences. There's the difference between the rural and the urban mind. Sharp, radical differences. So often so that sometimes a person from a town in Boston, a town in New Hampshire, and a person from the inner city in Boston can't even talk to one another. The person in one urban setting can sometimes talk with a person in a foreign country. If they could get an interpreter, they could communicate with one another more easily than they could living in the same country and in the same so-called basic culture, but one being urban and the other being rural. It is that radically different in the United States, even though they're watching the same television. It's just a demonstration that the television doesn't set all the things that are going on culturally. Now, what kind of city is Corinth? Well, it's helpful to know some things about the geography and history of Corinth. We're going to put on the board Dr. Fee's rough and dirty map. Ready, dirty, whatever. This is ancient Greece. All right? Looks just like it, right? Here is Athens, and here is Corinth, Sparta somewhere down in there. This peninsula, roughly drawn, is known as the Peloponnesus. It happens to be a very important factor in Greek history. In ancient Greece, all of these cities were independent city-states. They all served independently. I see those are looking on a map over here. You say, I got a pretty good drawing of it. It's not too bad. See, right here is the... You can come up and look at it afterwards. It's close. The thing that I don't show, of course, is that down here, all of this bottom end of the Peloponnesus, there is not a single harbor in the entire thing. There's no harbor at all. It's just like the fjords of Norway, only worse because you can't come in and... I mean, it's just simply rocky cliffs coming into the sea. Now, this became rather treacherous for mariners to travel much of the year. So very, very early, trade going from Rome east or from east to Rome simply learned to go through the Saronic Gulf, across to the Corinthian Gulf, and here. Now, of course, there's a canal there. That's only 4.5 miles across. Not more than 500 feet. I don't know how many kilometers that is, but, it's not very high. And Nero, in fact, started a canal. The canal was finally built at the end of the 19th century, and it's there now. Shipping goes through there. But back in antiquity, either they would, if the ships were small enough, they would put them on a pulley system. And they would put logs under the ships and just pulley the ship, putting a log out in front of each, just pull it up over the top of the what they call the diolchus, this isthmus here, and then hold it while it went down on pulleys on the other side, always putting a log in front of it and just slipped it down. That's a smaller ship. The larger ships simply came and unloaded their cargo, and then the cargo was landed across and then put on another ship and would go, and they would do the same thing. Now, Corinth strategically sat not actually on the coast itself. It has little seaports right here, one here and one here, Lycaon and Kenkre. You know about Kenkre in the New Testament because Paul went down to Kenkre to sail away. That's where he made the vow and shaved his head. That's the seaport on the other side. But Corinth stood in the strategic position of simply controlling all of that. Now, right outside the city of Corinth, right outside, I mean, just simply the city of Corinth was put up right next to this thing. There's a hill. Looks like a battleship. It goes 1,800 feet high, right up out of sea level. It sits there, and it sits with a flat top. It's called the Acrocorinthus, the Hill of Corinth. And on top of that hill, there was the temple to Aphrodite, which in antiquity before Paul's time was the place where the Vestal Virgins plied their trade. We're told over 1,000 of them were part of the temple prostitution of the cult of Aphrodite. This was in the time before Paul. Now, what becomes important for us historically, and this is the more important even than the geography, but the two things come together. The city of Corinth led the combined Greek city-states in its final stand against the Roman Empire. That is, Rome had flexed its wings, the eagle was flying, and had pretty well taken over all kinds of places. In fact, it had taken over by now most of Asia Minor, touched down and touched on some things in Egypt, all the way across Africa. It was just simply, it was in the 2nd century B.C., and it was doing its thing. By now, Athens and Sparta have fallen into, Athens is always Athens, but it was no longer leading the Greek city-states as it did at one time. And Corinth became the leading political center of this last hegemony of city-states over against Rome. And they held out for many, many years. In fact, it was called the Achaean League. Now, Achaea happens to be the name of the province of which Corinth is the capital. So the Achaean League was the league that is with Corinth as its head, resisted the Roman power until the year 146 B.C. In the year 146 B.C., the Roman consul Lucius Mummius finally came and conquered Corinth. And in the process of conquering Corinth, he simply sacked and leveled the city. Now, he didn't knock every stone down, because the temple of Apollo down in the heart of the city still stands with eight of its columns. Still, you can still see those, but those come from the what we call the Greek city, the time in the city that belonged in the Greek era. But the city was literally devastated. Nobody of any kind lived in Corinth for over 100 years, or about 100 years. Now, this is what is really important, because the city to which Paul came was an obviously bustling, clearly significant metropolis. But just 200 years before he had come, the city had been destroyed, and it lay desolate for 100 years. The city was refounded in the Roman Empire, in the Roman period. Now we call what we call the Roman city, as over against the Greek city. The city of Corinth was refounded in the year 44 BC. And it was founded as a Roman colony by Julius Caesar himself. Now you can do your own little figuring, 44 BC, and move that to zero and then up. Paul entered the city in the year 50 AD. That's one of the sure dates we have in the New Testament. We don't have many, but that one's sure. The reason for that is we have an inscription from Corinth in which Gallio, who was a proconsul of Corinth, actually has the inscription of when he became proconsul in Corinth. And we know the years that Gallio was proconsul in Corinth, and therefore Paul appeared before Gallio. We know when Paul was in Corinth. It's a happy coincidence for us. It's one of the sure dates in the New Testament. Now, back up and you've got less than 100 years, the city of Corinth has been going when Paul comes to it. Now, what happened was the city was founded basically by freedmen from Italy. But because the city was so strategically located, it simply had phenomenal overnight growth. It grew and just mushroomed. It became one of these cities like Capon in western United States, a kind of Los Angeles or Las Vegas. It just burst out and became a city overnight. Every kind of person was attracted to Corinth. Roman, Greek, Oriental, especially Jews. It was a totally cosmopolitan city. It was the cosmos in embryo. The entire known Greek world or Roman world all in one little package, even more than Rome in some ways because of the way it was founded. Now, prosperity very quickly came to the city, and a kind of prosperity that by the time of Paul made Corinth the leading city in Greece and the third leading city in the empire. Right behind Rome and Alexandria, there is Corinth. Now, all you have to do is use your imagination now to think of what kind of a city that had to have been. First of all, it is going to be a city that has no landed aristocracy. You know, there's nobody who can say, "My father came over in the Mayflower," to use an Americanism. There is nobody who can say, "We have owned land in Corinth many, many years." No landed aristocracy. But it's going to have an aristocracy, but what kind of aristocracy? An aristocracy of wealth, money. Money is what makes everything hum in Corinth. Commerce. It is a commercial city par excellence. And because it has an aristocracy of wealth, an aristocracy based on money, it was a city that had a fiercely independent spirit. You could go to Corinth and make it on your own. In this regard, it is precisely like Los Angeles, California in the United States. It has had a phenomenal growth, and the reason Los Angeles simply keeps growing and growing and growing, you know, it's a city of over 14 million people. I mean, there's lots of cities, but it's a city that you can start, and it takes you 3 hours to drive through. It's at 60 miles an hour. You know, it's just unreal. It goes and goes and goes and goes and goes. Why? Everybody goes to Los Angeles because there's where the money is. We're going to make money there. If nothing else, we're going to make some money. We're going to get to Los Angeles. Now, that's the kind of city that Corinth was. It just attracted people. And they came to Corinth to make their buck, to make their fast dollar. Now, in that kind of situation, there are going to be some other things, namely gross immorality. It is a city because it has no traditions, no deep past, anything goes. And everything did. You can visit, you can't unless you know what you're doing, but you can visit Corinth today, and if you ask the keeper of the museum, he might let you in if you have good reasons for it, but they've got a certain room in the museum they keep locked. It's the room that belongs to the god Asclepius, the god of healing. And in this room, they have all of the, or an awful lot of the finds of the discoveries at the temple of the god Asclepius that had his temple in the city of Ismia, which is just 2 miles down the road from Corinth. And in the temple, the people would bring their votive offerings to Asclepius. And what they did was that they would make a plaster of the part of their body that Asclepius, they wanted Asclepius to heal, or that Asclepius had healed. That is, they would actually make a plaster of it, plaster Paris kind of thing, and then bring it as their way of offering it to Asclepius. They have hanging on the wall in this room, the god of Asclepius, one wall that is filled with these artifacts of plaster, and over 50% of them are men's and women's genitals, which are simply the votives of syphilis and venereal diseases. It was that kind of city. It was a city in which immorality was absolutely that was the way it was. In fact, they had made a name, a word, a verb out of the name Corinth, Corinthianazo, to Corinthianize. That's the Greeks had this word in their vocabulary, to Corinthianize. That was a way of saying that somebody had really gone to the devil. You know, even by pagan standards, to be a Corinthian was something else. Now, that's the kind of city it was also. Now, besides all of this, it was a city, because it had wealth, that had... It kind of had what I call purchased sophistication. You know what I mean? Money can buy a lot of things. Money, for example, in Los Angeles has bought itself a pretty good symphony. Maybe not the world's best symphony, but it really ranks high among the world's great symphonies. Now, Los Angeles hasn't been around long enough to have a symphony like London or like New York, but it has one. How so? Because they can buy it there. It's very faint. Los Angeles is the most plastic city in the face of the earth. Immediate plastic create, you know, you can create it because money can do anything. All you have to do if you want to start a religion, go to Los Angeles. Go to MacArthur Park, get on your, and get started. You got a following. Every religion in the United States almost, except Mormonism, Los Angeles, it's where it happens. And besides all of this, it buys this kind of what I call pseudo-sophistication. It tries to have all of the libraries and all the culture that this means. That's exactly what Corinth was like. They had more marble per square inch than any city in Greece, anywhere. I mean, everywhere marble. They had no less than 26 temples and shrines to the pagan gods in the city, all marble and, you know, magnificently arrayed. We know this because the Greek historian Pausanias just simply walked through the city and told us all about this. It's a beautiful description of ancient Corinth. You sit down and read it yourself today in Pausanias' descriptions of Greece. It was a place, therefore, that attracted itinerants, philosophers. If you wanted to, if you were a philosopher and you weren't making it big in Athens, you could go to Corinth and make it big and make money anyway, because there'd always be somebody that'd give you some money. And it just so happens that that's how the philosophers made it in antiquity. That is, they did it by by setting up stand and getting a bunch of followers, and then those followers would give them money. Now, Paul, you understand, comes into the city of Corinth and has to, if you will, compete into that kind of a setting. This is going to be the basic background to the problem in the church in Corinth. They are treating the Christian gospel and thinking of Paul as simply another of these philosophers that's doing his thing in Corinth. Christianity is another expression of Sophia, wisdom, for some of them. That's what's going on. That's what's creating the havoc in the church. Now, it seems to me that it's important to know all of that. In fact, Corinth, ancient Corinth, is at one and the same time the Los Angeles, Las Vegas, and New York of antiquity, all wrapped into one. Now, it is into this kind of city that the Apostle Paul comes and stakes out a claim for God. It is in the city of Corinth, which one man has beautifully said, there is a church of God in Vanity Fair. Here is Vanity Fair, to be sure. And there's a temple of God in that city. God's option to all of the rest of this that is Corinth. Now, it's obvious that the temple of God has a lot of gray areas. It's not always looking like God's alternative, God's option. There are all kinds of problems in the church, but understandable problems given that these are recent converts out of total paganism, for the most part. There might be a few Jews. In fact, I'm convinced there are some Jews, but for the most part, total pagans. They've come out of this, you know, they don't have a long history of what the Christian faith is. The Christian faith is simply their religion that they've accepted. And in sometimes that hasn't really, you know, it hasn't filtered through to them what all that means yet. This is what makes Corinthians, by the way, such an exciting document for those of you who are in the kinds of ministries that YWAM is in, where you're out in the streets of the cities of the world and the byways of the world, and you have to come to grips with theology in exactly the same way. How does it work out in life? Because if it doesn't work out in life, something's wrong, not with the theology, but with your thinking. Because if it's true, it's going to work, you understand. And it is true, and therefore it's going to work, and it will work, but it's got to work out in the street. It's just that we don't want to lose the foundation, namely the theology, before we move out into the street. And Corinthians is just an exciting place to do this. Now, once we've done all of that, that is, once we've sat and listened and got the historical context and done some words with content and all of that, that is, once we've worked on step one, then we turn to the real crux, which is step three. How do we move from step one to step three? Well, here is a place that I've done some of my own work, and I'm just going to try to make some suggestions to you and use some language that I'll probably have to modify in some way, explain. But here's the first rule for me, hermeneutics. When we have what I call comparable particulars, that is, where the particulars in my culture are comparable to the particulars in their culture, then the Word of God says the same thing to us that it said to them. For example, where we still have men and women who are sinners, and where these people can offend one another or do another brother in, and where that brother can take his first brother, the man that has been offended or has been done in, can take his brother to a civil court, we have comparable particulars. Now, not exact. You understand, the civil court in Corinth is not like the civil court in the United States or like in Lausanne. But nonetheless, we have comparable particulars. We still have men and women. We still have the possibilities of them being at odds with one another over civil matters and the possibilities of going to a court, a civil court, with their business. Once we have what are truly comparable particulars, then we just simply have to go back and hear what God was saying to them and move that right into our situation, with the proviso, of course, that the court isn't always exactly the same, and we've got to be aware of that. But the problems don't lie where we have comparable particulars. The problems lie where we don't have those things that are comparable. How do we go about getting from steps 1 and 2 to step 3 where there is absolutely nothing comparable in our culture? And there's a related question. How does one determine what is cultural? That is, what belongs in the first century, and what is transcultural? That is, what belongs to every age. Now, I don't have easy answers to this, but I'm going to wrestle with this just for a few moments in this lecture. The problem of cultural relativity. Now, in all candor, I think we all need to admit that we bring our own cultural predispositions to the biblical text. If we're raised in a culture, in a Christian culture now, as myself, where women pray and prophesy and teach and preach, then when I come to 1 Timothy 2, verses 9 to 15, I see that text somehow as culturally conditioned. I can't help myself. And the reason I can't help myself is because I'm in a context where women minister with all of the gifts of God. That is, the Holy Spirit seemed to be indiscriminate about sex. He didn't know any better, and he simply gave women the gifts of ministry. And in that context, I was raised. When I come to 1 Timothy 2, 9 to 15, there's no question about my own situation is going to inform me when I come to that text. And you say, that shouldn't happen. If it's God's word, you should change your culture. But my point is that God not only did this, but these women have had great ministries among us. Who am I that I can withstand God is my answer always to that. If this is something God is doing, then I've got to find out in light of what God is really doing how I'm to understand that text in 1 Corinthians 2. And that's not easy. But at least I'm aware that I'm, you know, coming with that in hand when I come to the text. What I'd like to remind my Presbyterian friends is that they're also coming into their very patriarchal, with their very patriarchal mentality to the same text and think that somehow they're non-culturally conditioned when they're as culturally conditioned as I am. But at least I admit it. I have a hard time getting them to admit it at times. Now, this is not easy. And I admit that. And in fact, I'm concerned about those that are sometimes raising voices in protest. They're arguing the resorting to culture is to escape the clear mandate of the inspired word. Somebody says, cultural, and then you don't have to obey it anymore. I'm aware that that's happening. And I'm concerned about that. But I can make a distinction between what is moral and what is cultural. And that's one of the things that we've got to wrestle with in the process of these texts. Now, what do we do? Well, we begin with the obvious, okay? That's the best place to begin. Begin with the obvious. Some things are clearly cultural, and some things clearly transcend culture. That is, there are those indicatives and imperatives that don't need you or me or anybody else to interpret them. We know what they mean. The text says all have sinned. You know, that's pretty straightforward. We don't have to try to figure out, does that include me? I mean, all you have to do is put that in the context of that whole argument, and if it doesn't include you, then you're not a human being on the face of the earth, because that includes everybody. All have sinned. You don't need my interpretation to get to the truth of that text. Oh, there are the imperatives. Put on as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassion and kindness, lowliness, meekness and patience, forbearing one another. If one has a complaint against another, forgiving one another. You know? You don't need any interpretation of that text. You need the grace to obey it. That's pretty straightforward stuff. You don't need me to come along and say, hey, that text means. I know what it means, and so do you. The real problem is doing it. And we can begin with those texts. Those are pretty clearly above culture. But, on the other hand, for Western man, the eating or non-eating of food that has been offered to idols is of no consequence to us. I don't know anybody that's wrestling with whether he's going to eat food that's been offered previously to an idol or whether he's going to go down to the temple and actually partake of the food there in the presence of the idol. Do you know anybody like that? I just don't know anybody. Now, that's non-Western culture. I mean, that's Western culture. In some non-Western cultures, that will still be true. But not in Western culture. And that's my culture. So, there's only one possible way for God to speak in that text. And that is that we've got to translate, number one, into a comparable situation. That is, I don't have anybody who is wrestling with whether to go to the temple or not. But there are some things, it seems to me, that are really very comparable to that in our situation. And that's where it takes the hard work and the divine grace of what I call a sanctified imagination. Not a too great an imagination, but simply thinking. We've got to come to grips with the fact that the particular is different, but the Word of God is going to be the same. How do we get that same Word of God now into a new context? And we'll do some of that along the way. Now, I grant you that not all obvious things are equally obvious to all. That is, that's one of the great ways. I accuse my German scholar friends of winning all their arguments by saying, obviously. You don't... Obviously, it means, you know, and once you say obviously and pound the table hard enough, then you don't have to back it up with any evidence. You've just simply won the day by using the word obviously. Clearly it means. Well, that's not so clear to everybody. What do you mean clearly? It's clear to me, maybe, but not clear to all. So one of the things we have to wrestle with is, the fact that not all things are clearly clear, obvious to all. But given the fact that there are some things that are obvious and some things that are not, you know, that are more obscure, we go on. What do? Well, we work hard. And among the things that we need to be aware of is the fact that we do have to translate particulars from one setting to another. We have to come to grips with the fact that culture changes, even sometimes where the particulars are the same. That is, The question of women, for example, in the church, which is a live issue in so many situations today. Well, all of those texts are addressed to a situation where women were personal possessions of men, were addressed to situations where they had no status in society, were addressed to situations where they stayed home, had no possibilities of education, who only ventured forth in many of those cultures with veils on their faces, and whose husbands were contracted by fathers. Now, if you want to take all of those texts and bring them immediately into the 20th century, you better be prepared for moving the culture into the 20th century. You better send all the women in this place home and have them go back and wait for their fathers to get them wives, because that's the context. I'm get the fathers to get them husbands. Thank you for that correction. You know what I mean. It's one of those things. Take me for what I mean, not always for what I say. We have to do that with Paul, too, at times. No. So we have to wrestle with those things, and we're going to do it. Now, our time has come to the end. And I thought we were going to spend some time this morning on seeing the whole. I don't know how we're going to get back to that unless we do it in our first session tomorrow morning, because we don't have time in the 2 minutes that are left for us to come to grips with the whole letter. But we can say just a quick word about it. And that is that the letter is obviously occasioned by two different things. It comes from two places. In chapter 1, verse 10, Paul says, "It has been reported to me by Chloe's people." And then we find in 5:1, "It has been reported that." And then we find again in chapter 11, verse 18, "It has been reported to me." Now it becomes clear that somebody has been telling Paul what's been going on in the church. Then in 7:1, Paul says, "Now concerning the matters about which you wrote." And then from there on, throughout the rest of the book, we find a little recurring rubric. Now concerning. It occurs in 7:25, and in 8:1, and in 12:1, and in 15:1, and in 16:1, and in 16:12. Now concerning. If we take seriously that structure, that means that Paul is taking up the items in their letter one by one. Now concerning this. So, the letter is a combination of these two things.